tracking down a hunter who's 1/12 in size. Here's a look at the new Mezco Predator Jungle Hunter 1/12 collective figure. The 1/12 Collective Predator is outfitted in battle armor with thermal netting and fortified chest plate, allowing for greater mobility while hunting. The Ruthless Hunter comes with two removable bandoliers made from bones of his prey and features a head portrait with interchangeable mouthpiece and light-up bio helmet, all attached via magnets. While we're still able to track this guy before he disappears into the trees, the first thing we want to do before we get down to the details and the accessories that come included with the brand new 1/12 Collective Predator, grabbing the tape measure, let's see just how tall the figure stands. And also in a moment, stay tuned, I'll be also bringing in a NECA figure for comparisons. In the meantime though, the Predator stands 7¼ inches in height, or the figure's 18.5 centimeters tall. And as I'd like to think I'm a person who sticks to his promises, let's move over the 1/12 Collective Predator. And although he's not sharing the same head sculpt, he is sharing, though, however, a very similar body to the one to the left. This happens to be the Jungle Hunter Predator from NECA Toyz. The reasoning why I did want to bring this one in is, while maybe some of you yet have not had the chance to pick up the 1/12 Collective Predator, many of you, I'm sure, may have a Predator from NECA in your collection, and you can see when you're putting them side to side like this that the 1/12 Collective Predator is slightly smaller than the Jungle Hunter we get from NECA. For your homework assignment, I'm handing around sheets to the class right now. Luckily, you'll be happy to know it's only on one single sheet. There's nothing printed on the back, so it's a pretty simple, straight-through read. Why I bring this to your attention is it shows you where to put the things on the Predator's body, but more importantly, how to put in the LR521 button cell batteries that are in fact included with this figure. Two of which actually have to go inside of his forehead to light up the side scope on his helmet. The other ones actually go inside his medic pack, and that actually will light up the plasma caster cannon that mounts on the top of his shoulder. Like I said, a pretty simple read. You didn't have to really didn't even have to take that home, and nor am I really going to request that you guys have your parents sign for it either. Okay, so the figure comes included also with a display stand. This is something I obviously did want to talk about. There's a few things I don't like about this figure, one of which is the way they've designed the display stand. Not necessarily the shape, I have nothing against circles necessarily, but I have a real issue with the way they've printed the font of Predator. It looks good until you realize where the actual figure has to stand on top of it. There's two different ways of displaying this, all like with the other 1/12 Collective figures we've looked at. You can either go the route, the basic route of having standing on the stand be the provided hole, the peg that's on the top here. Or you can also get yourself an adjustable neck. Now the neck swaps out for the peg that's here, and it does allow then the Predator to be in a more dynamic pose. Knuckled in four different places, there's a joint here, a here, here, and a here. And the one on the end here is the most important one. This is going to be clipping around the Predator's waist. But like I said, this is adjustable, and this is going to then swap the places with the peg that's right here. We're going to do that in a moment. I did, though, want to draw your attention again. I know I was talking a little bit about the font. If you take, though, the Predator figure, for all intents and purposes, you would want to have it like this, or maybe even up like this. Now, certainly, though, you'd want to have at least the Predator readable so you'd be able to see it when you have it on the shelf. But where they've actually put the peg is no fault necessarily of Mezco, because that's normally where all the pegs go on their stands. They're not using a brand new stand in this case. They have to use the ones that they already have the molding for. They should have really changed the placement of the font. Because if you're going to take the Predator figure and attach him on, because he does have peg holes on the undersides of his feet after all, if you plug him onto the display stand, for example, the figure only then works if you've got the font facing on an angle. If, though, you're saying to yourself, well, can't you just have the figure? Well, you can have him off to the side, but then it looks like he's been scolded and standing in the corner. Again, I really don't think necessarily I would have expected them to change the placement of the peg, because again, they're using the same stand they always use with these 1/12 Collective figures. But at the very least, I think they should have really placed the logo in a different area. Because again, like if you're going to be putting him dead center, you can't put him dead center this way. So you have to put him centered the opposite direction. The opposite direction. And of course, that's going to make the font look all wonky. As I did say, though, you can swap the peg out, though. And if you did want to put in the actual adjustable neck, first of all, you have to remove this. And in the past, I've normally recommended that you could just take the bottom peg and push it from the bottom to force that through. And sometimes that does do a good job of actually removing it. But if you still have a tough time, as I did have prior to hitting record, you can also use yourself a regular display stand. This just happens to be from McFarlane Toys. Just put it on the bottom, fit it into the hole, and then just apply pressure. And essentially then what you would be doing, Brian, you got it all lined up here, you'd be then forcing the peg, I find, a lot easier. Just want to make sure you don't lose that after all. Just to then remove that, we can go ahead then and take the adjustable neck. That's plugging then into place. And then from there, you can go ahead and take your Predator figure. Now, I'm not going to spend the next hour or so getting this guy in a perfect looking pose, but you can also get him then in an adjustable neck. The neck isn't really strong enough to hold him in any sort of leaping in the air pose unless you then really start to tighten up the screws. It'll hold it for right now, but eventually those screws will start to loosen, the knuckle joints will start to give, and your poor Predator will take a tumble. As for the figure's accessories, I suppose one thing I probably could have talked about when we looked at the display stand is that the figure comes included with the 112 collective baggie. There's a little space as well that you can write in who the character is. So you can write in Predator. You can also even write your name. You could also even write in Don't Touch for anybody that had any wandering eyes as they wanted to grab those accessories. I always like that they include things like this. It's a pretty, you know, for what it is, it's a pretty decent quality bag. It doesn't feel flimsy or anything along those lines. A lot of times for me, at least, I usually just put the accessories that I'm not currently using back into the tray. But if you are one that likes to store a lot of their things in storage, like all those extra boxes that you have piling up as a collector, we're all responsible for it. You can't see it right now, but I've got quite the collection of empty boxes behind me. But I suppose this is one workaround to that. It's just having a baggie available with all the accessories and the name of the character, or Don't Touch, written down below. Okay, so let's have a look at the accessories now that come include with the Predator. And I've already taken the liberty as well of installing those button cell batteries. Luckily, again, like the button cell batteries are included with the figure, so you don't have to start going online. You don't have to go to places like Radio Shack. Does Radio Shack even exist anymore? I don't think it does. I think it was now the Source, here in Canada at least. Maybe the Source is even around anymore. What is even around? Where do you buy your batteries? Amazon. Amazon's usually the place. Okay, so like I said, we get a whole bunch of different things we can have a look at here. You get a couple of skull bandoliers. Skull bandoliers. One looks like it happens to be like spinal cords, if that's the thing that Predator likes to collect. The other one happens to be tiny, tiny little skulls. These things, I'm sure, were not much of a hunt. But either way, though, like we've gotten cases before with other jungle hunters, he gets his own variety of these. These can then wrap around his torso. Of course, a lot of that will involve me having to remove the head, which we'll do more in a second. And then he also has a little necklace piece. Tiny little bones. Wishbones. Somewhat ironic if the wishbone belonged to somebody else. I'm sure their only wish was, don't kill me. Wish didn't come true. Anyways, he comes included with these. These are all just plastic, by the way, and they all have the same black threading. Again, we're going to fit it over top of his body in a second. The figure also comes included with a pair of swappable hands, and actually several pairs of swappable hands. He comes with first close fists. Not going to be serving much of a purpose, at least when... I mean, really, to be fair, he doesn't come with a lot of accessories. Like, he doesn't come with a spear, for example, or he doesn't come with a smart disc, anything along those lines. If you're looking for combi sticks, I suppose you probably could use one that came included with, like, a NECA figure, for example. So I guess closed fists aren't not necessarily a far-fetched thing to come included with. He comes with a pair of those. The figure comes included as well with sort of a pointing hand and also a gripping hand. And then he also comes with more a gestured hand or a slightly wider grip hand. Now, for the next thing he's going to come included with, it's probably best advised to use this hand, the smaller grip one, as the figure comes included with a freshly yanked skull, and along with that, a spinal cord. I say freshly yanked, as it certainly looks like it's got still settled blood on it. He hasn't polished it off yet. Fine-looking skull, though. Not that I would be a judge of what looks to be a good-looking skull and spinal cord. I would really hate to be a judge of that. But I gotta say, like, that looks pretty good. It doesn't have a wire frame or anything like that, so you can't bend it or anything along those lines. But yeah, if you did want to take yourself the hand, for example, plastic's pretty soft on these too, so you shouldn't have to heat these up. Of course, if you do have any problems, calling me a liar to say that, you can always just use a hairdryer and just soften up the plastic. And of course, the hand is best to hold... This hand specifically is best to hold the skull and spinal cord. So there's that. The figure also comes included with two types of extended blades from his gauntlet. The longer variety is these ones. The shorter variety, and the ones that most likely will be lost, are these ones here. These can just attach to the side of the figure's body. Here onto the side, you'll notice, not the one that has, not the detonator. No, you don't want to get near that anytime soon. But right here, you'll see there's a couple of slots that you can then take the smaller blades, just kind of move his hand out of the way, and the blades then fit into these tiny little slots. It's kind of really hard to kind of get in there, but they slot in place. There's the shorter variety. Let's see if we can get the other one going here. While I'm doing this, I keep thinking to myself, well, you know what I'm thinking. It's nothing to do with blades. It has to do with losing things. But yeah, those plug into place. The easier ones to plug in, obviously, are the longer variety because you have a lot more to hold on to when it comes to the plastic. But again, like those just slot into those grooves. I did notice, though, on mine at least, that this slot here, the opening that allows for the blade to go in, actually seems a little bit more generous with the space. See this one here? This one? This one right here is a little bit more narrow. I might even have to take myself like a little screwdriver, see if I can pry that open just a little bit more. So he comes included with those. And then the figure comes included with a plasma caster. Now, the plasma caster is a separate component piece. What's rather interesting about it is it does have a removable medic pack. I don't even think we've gotten that from another company where an actual medic pack is removable. Technically, it's not true for this one right here, as he does actually come with two varieties of it, two variations of it. These, you simply just pop one out, replace it with this one. This is the one that counts, at least if you want a medic pack, as right to the side here, there is a little tiny, you might even need yourself a screwdriver to gain access to this. Got myself a little flathead. Just get a screwdriver in there, and you can lift the flap up, kind of like opening up a tiny little coffin, and inside is the medic pack that the Predator can carry around with him. Fold that up. You can take this and you just remove the whole back section here. And unfortunately, though, when you are removing it, you usually end up removing the cover as well. But this just slides out. We're going to get back to that one in a moment. And then this just then sits onto the back of the plasma caster. Very easy to remove. Just, again, wiggle that off, detach it, sort of like you're cartridging a gun. And that just loads onto the back of the body. If, though, you did want to have one that has a light-up function, though, you have this one, which is pretty much identical, I would say it's pretty much identical to the one that we already had a look at here. If you look at the two, one doesn't necessarily tell you that this is the one that's light-up, other than there's these kind of copper plates that are on the top, the connections that, of course, will illuminate the plasma caster cannon. This will just slide out of the caster the same way as what we just looked at with the medic pack. The thing you have to do differently, though, is this one. Again, we'll just grab the screwdriver here. Everything is so small in these. You just lift this up. And again, like I've already taken the liberty of installing the button cell batteries. These were the easier of the two to install because you're just going to be putting them. Whoa, I almost dropped it. Almost dropped it. There's the button cell batteries right there. And then we can go ahead and just put that back in place. You definitely don't want to be losing the cover, whatever you do. And then this actually sits back inside. Now, one thing actually to do, though, you can also remove this. And then this illuminates. The thing about it, though, is there's no way to know, as I just now have dropped it onto the floor. Let me just go grab that. And the floor claims another victim. Luckily, I was able to at least retrieve it. Where were we? Anyways, like I said, once you've installed the batteries, there is an on switch that's just located here to the top. The thing is, as it's in its state right now, there's no way to know whether it's on and off. Now, you're thinking to yourself, well, am I going to have to remove this every single time and just by chance happen to turn it on and then know exactly whether it's lit up or not? Well, technically, no. What you can do is slide this back into the plasma caster. And then this part actually, again, detaches. And for some reason, it always gets hung up here. Just remove that like so. You can always keep this battery compartment always permanently installed. If you're not one that worries about the medic pack and having that be included with the figure, then just always have this part installed. And then from there, you just switch this on to illuminate the cannon. And again, the on and off switch is located right here. I've already lost this a couple of times onto the floor. Usually it will stay in place, but every so often as I'm banging or moving the figure around, especially for his articulation, this battery cover ends up falling off. So again, just be careful of that. But just again, this detaches. It's either too stubborn or it's too loose. It's never meeting me in the middle. Anyways, again, you just switch this on. And then again, this illuminates the cannon. Now, there is a wire that runs from the battery compartment. So you got to imagine if you would have an X-ray vision, you'd be able to see inside. The battery compartment runs through these wires and then illuminates the top of the cannon. So I'm sure I don't have to tell you, you got to be really careful to these two wires that they don't get clipped in any way. Because the moment they get clipped, That's the day that you kill the light. There is articulation technically on the cannon itself. You can move it back and forth. You can also wiggle this up and down. But just again, be careful of those two wires. Okay, so we're going to go ahead and put this back in place, make sure it's fully secure there. And then when you are attaching this onto the predator's body, for all intents and purposes, you would think that it would go on this way. But instead, in fact, it actually slides on sideways. So you line everything up. And here's the track, by the way, right here. And then this is the part that it slides then into. So you slide this in. I suppose probably should have turned the light off in order to do this, but still, though, we're just going to take the back here, slide it in place. Watch for the dreads, of course. And once that's in place, then you've got the illuminated light there on the top for the cannon. And boy, does that ever look nice. There is, again, another option as well. You can display it either with just the light illuminated like this, or he does also have a blast effect that's done here in the translucent blue plastic. Once that's plugged in, you can see really how brightly that illuminates. It does, though, unfortunately, add some weight to the cannon, so the cannon is going to flop over, at least on mine here. I may be able to go in there and tighten up the joint just a little bit, but it does sit, unfortunately, really loose here on my figure. Okay, so while this one actually is illuminated, the other option for lighting up is actually the little laser scope that he has on the side of the helmet. To get access to that, he's going to take the helmet, almost as if you're going to unhelmet the Predator, even though he does technically come with another head sculpt. But you're going to kind of get your finger in here, just underneath the ledge, and you want to pry this off. Everything seems to work with magnets, although the magnets here on the front of the faceless Predator seems the stronger of the two things. Anyways, we just remove that, put that to the side, and then I've already, again, unscrewed this. I've installed the two required button cell batteries, and then you just hit the switch here to the side, and it illuminates the light. Not all that impressive, honestly, until you actually get yourself the helmet on. And then you can see it illuminates those three beads of red. And between collectively, the two, actually it's fun the fact that they would have included light up functions. This I'm a little more worried about, simply just because, again, like those two wires, if something was to happen with those wires, I mean, that's just the end of it. But I love the idea that this would actually have illuminated. And this is the easier of the two. And then just again, to turn this off, just detach this. I always end up removing the battery compartment. Every single time I've done this, I always end up removing the battery cover in the process. But again, we're just going to detach this, wiggle this off. And then from there, we're just going to switch this off just to make sure that, like I said, it's not going to illuminate. I guess for right now, what I could technically do is really take the medic pack and just put that in its place. That way I don't even have to worry about the light up functions at all. But again, like to go back to the helmet while it's still illuminated, I think Mezco has really done a great job of the helmeted version of Predator. I have to stress that, because the one thing I don't like about this figure, other than the display stand we've already talked about, is the alternate head sculpt that the figure comes included with as well. And for that, let's just go ahead and just pop this back off. Very strong magnets on this. Remove this. There we go. And we're just going to switch this back off because we don't want to be killing the battery. Here's the issue I have with this figure. It's not this head sculpt necessarily. I mean, if I was just to get this figure with the way it is right now and this specific head sculpt, I would be quite a happy collector. And I still really am. The idea, though, that we get this head sculpt is really the part of my conflict. And this is the part that I really don't care about for the figure itself. The Mezco 112 Collective Predator does come included, for all intents and purposes, with an unhelmeted head sculpt. Not necessarily that I'm dismissing that it's an unhelmeted head sculpt. I really don't like the paint on this. The paint, I feel, is too faded, if that's the best way I could really describe it. A lot of all the features seem so lost because, unfortunately, just the way they've painted this figure, it doesn't seem like anything is really super sharp or contrasting in colors. The darker black that would normally make the crest crown of the Predator in the movie, unfortunately, here it gets less black and gets a lot more just brown. And because the colors are so similar in color scheme, it ends up just kind of giving you a very muddy-looking face for the Predator. I also really don't like his eyes either. Now, he does come with two variations of mandibles. He comes with the ones that are currently open, and he also comes with ones that close. These ones aren't so bad. The way they've actually taken the lighter coloring up the plastic and they've transitioned some of that brown into it actually does look pretty good. Until you replace the mouth. The mouth, again, works on those magnets, so we just go ahead and remove that. Put this one in place. Now, you can really see the divide here of where a lighter color of plastic meets then the painted color for the top of his crown. I suppose it is the nicer of the two heads. I do like the, I always really like the closed mandibles, especially on Jungle Hunter. It's sculpted well, but I almost feel like the paint is really the thing that lets the figure down. In both the cases, actually, they have softer dreadlocks here. So when it comes to changing out the heads, they're actually not that hard to do. Just go ahead and grab the head. We're going to remove it from the post here. And while we're not doing that, of course, we want to make sure that the dreads don't get stuck. Let's just slide the caster off for right now. Yeah, we're going to go ahead and take the head off completely. Put the faceplate back in place as well. And just again, before I start swapping things around, I wanted to show you guys the difference with the head sculpts. This is good. This could have been good had the paint only just been a little bit better. And again, you've just changed the heads. We're going to go ahead and pop this back on. Make sure that you're not, of course, even though this is softer plastic, you just want to make sure that you're not pinching any of the dreads when you put the head back in place. Now, actually, when you get this guy out of the packaging, he actually starts with this head sculpt. But I decided for the reveal, like in the movie, it would make more sense to actually start the review with the helmeted head sculpt. You can certainly weigh your thoughts in down below. But while I do think no fault on Mezco for giving us a good head sculpt in both the cases, I just wish like the paint was so much nicer on the unhelmeted head. There's just so much more browns and a whole lot less blacks that the features almost get lost on this figure. Certainly when it goes for the rest of the figure's details, overall I'm pretty happy with what was delivered here. You got all, again, the colors of the brown mixed with mostly like a beige color scheme, similar to what he would have had in the movie. He has a lot of these sort of whisker details that he's got painted all over his body. I find that they're a little bit more detracting, I think, from the way they've painted the figure, because it sort of looks like he's just got arm hair, like really heavy arm hair all over his body. He's got the netting, of course, that's all over most, at least, of his body. He's got the loincloth. Then, again, all the armor pieces that he has been nicely painted here in gunmetal gray. Like, I don't have any real issues if I was to cover off his face and look at the rest of the body. Like, he is an overall good-looking figure. It's only really here that I have the biggest issue with it. Like, in also the movie, he does have the open plate cover there for his gauntlet that does reveal inside his self-destruct. You can see that slightly. I mean, they're there, but they're very faintly detailed, very faintly printed. Again, the little hinge that you can open and close there. But yeah, you know, again, like overall, I don't have so much an issue with the actual body. It's more the execution of the paint for the unhelmeted head sculpt. Now, for me, at least, I'm still going to be displaying the Predator on my shelf with this look rather than this look. So it's not necessarily a deal breaker. If you're somebody that doesn't really like the looking of this one, but you're probably just going to be displaying the guy with this head sculpt anyways, then really, this is not something that's going to be the breaker, the deal breaker that's going to say, well, you know what, I don't want to pick up the figure because I really don't like the way that this guy's head is painted. You're likely going to be probably displaying this guy with the helmet head sculpt anyways. For the articulation on this guy, the head is on a ball joint, and it's probably a good thing too. I did remove the caster, so it's a little easier to actually rotate the head. You can rotate the head for most cases all the way around. You can have the head looking quite high up also as well, or you can have the head looking quite low down. Shoulders are on joints. Now, with the joints, this shoulder is the thing you're going to have to be careful of. Like with cases before, if you rotate the arm too far back, you can already see it's going to start to pull this little cable here tight. And if you pull it too far back, it's going to pop right off. You don't want that. So just be careful when it comes to rotating this specific arm. This arm, you can rotate fine all the way around. The shoulder is actually, the shoulder plate or cover is actually attached to the top of his torso here. So it doesn't impede any articulation when it comes to the figure's arms. You can bring the arms out as well. You can also do the same thing on this side. The figure doesn't, while not possessing a ball joint in or torso joint in his bicep joint. He does, however, though, have a joint where you can rotate the elbow. You can also bring the arms back and forth this way. Hands also rotate all the way around. The figure has an upper torso ball joint, and despite for the fact he's actually inside of a webbing here, the net doesn't impede any of the articulation when it comes to the figure, so you can not only move the upper torso all the way around, but you can also hinge the lower joint also. Legs do split out, and you can see, similar to the shoulders here, these little plate covers are actually attached to his loincloth, not attached to his legs. So it doesn't limit any articulation there either. You can move the legs forward, you can move the legs back. There's a mild swivel at the top of the thigh, double hinge here on the knee. Just though, be careful, because I've noticed the few times I've done this, it pulls right away against the webbing, the netting, and you really don't want that ripped either. When it comes to the feet, they move up and down. You can also ankle rock them as well. So yeah, the figure does have some decent articulation. The only thing I don't care about when it comes to the Predator figure here from Mezco Toyz, overall, I'm really overall happy with it, is I don't like the way they printed the font. That's not a deal breaker at all. And I don't like the way they've painted the head sculpt either. Whether you decide to go with this head sculpt or the one that actually has the open mandibles, getting a closer look at the detail on that. Either way, though, I think the paint is really underwhelming here on the head sculpt. Still, for me, I'm going to still be ultimately displaying the head sculpt like this. So for me, I probably won't even be seeing this head. It's going to only go back into the plastic tray. But for anybody that was looking to display the Predator unmasked like this, you might be a tad bit disappointed with exactly the way that Mezco painted the figure's head sculpt. Overall, I would say I'm more happier with the Mezco 112 Collective Predator than I am unhappy. My unhappiness only stems more from the paint that they applied to the unhelmeted head sculpt that we just happened to be looking at here in Final Looks, and the way that they've actually put the logo across the display stand. I know some would just be looking at the display stand saying, who cares? Who cares where they've put the font? I care. And even again, it's a small little criticism, but I do wish that they could have put it the font of the Predator facing the same direction of where the Predator's feet are supposed to be placed. Because I don't expect them to start moving the pegs around on the display stands. They've already got the mold for it. I don't expect them to start remolding and retooling a brand new base just to simply appease me. Don't do that, whatever you do. But at the very least, they probably could have either shrunk the font down and moved it around so at least it would be lined up with the figure when you have him on the shelf. My bigger issue is really stemming more from the paint that they applied to the figure's head sculpt. It's a lot of browns. And because there is so much brown against the backdrop of an already beigey brown kind of plastic, a lot of the features I feel, at least when it comes to the Predator, get almost lost. And speaking of lost, I feel like his eyes also get lost too. I don't know what they've done differently to the eyes that NECA seemed to do a better job with when it came to their Jungle Hunter, but the eyes seem like they seem so vacant, so lifeless when we're looking at the figure's head sculpt. The end of the day, here's the problem with the 112 collective figures, is that you're dealing with a figure that's $100 plus. I ordered this one actually over on Entertainment Earth's website, and I know I paid over $100. I couldn't give you the exact amount. I could certainly provide the link down below in the video description, but I can tell you for over $100, this is the thing that could be the deal breaker for many, because of course we did bring in a NECA Predator, Jungle Hunter Predator, that is for the same, you could say is apples to apples. It's not the case where they're doing something completely different here. If I had a hot toy, that would be a completely different thing altogether. First of all, you're dealing with a 12-inch tall figure that would have had a lot more things going for it. Other than just really, if you consider the illuminated helmet and the illuminated plasma caster cannon, really isn't that much different between this one and the NECA. And then yet Mezco, when it comes to 112 collective figures, are asking you, the collector, to be essentially paying three times as much as a NECA Predator figure. The question is, though, is it really worth paying three times as much for? If you are already in that collecting space of 112 collectible figures, then you're probably already going to be collecting something like this. I think for what you're getting, at least for $100, I think you're getting a lot of cool stuff going with the Predator, most of which we have already seen with a NECA before. And to be also fair, with NECA Predator figures, you tend to get a lot more accessories as well. So really a lot of it has to do with just more light up functions on this Predator. And you could maybe even say maybe more details to the actual figure's body, but really not that much either. Is this what you would consider a figure that's worth three times as much as what we're getting with a NECA figure? You can let me know down below in the comments section. Normally, again, I'm not one that collects a lot of the 112 collective figures simply just because of the price. I wish, again, like the price, at the very least, could be double the price of what NECA is charging. If this was a $60 figure, I'd have a harder time to pass on him. But when he's three times as much, you really have to kind of look at the features between the two companies and two lines of Predator figures and ask yourself, is Mezco doing things better? They have it illuminated in the plasma caster. They have it illuminated with the scope on the side of the helmet. But is that enough to justify three times the price of what they're asking for these figures? You can let me know certainly down below in the comments section. Again, I did pick this one up over on Entertainment Earth's website. If you guys are interested and would like to get your hands on the brand new 112 Collective Predator, certainly click the link down below in the video description. And also, as well, if you enjoyed this video, why not hit with a like? If you love the content you guys are seeing and certainly do want to stick around for more, I just realized I haven't put on the bone bandolier anywhere on this figure's body. I looked at it in the review. I'm just looking at it right now. It's spinning around in the rotisserie. I completely left it off. Oh, biscuits. Either way, though, like I said, certainly stick around because we are going to be having a lot more videos coming your way. So as always, guys, thanks for watching. See you guys next time.